Welcome to Vlogmas Day 5.
I'm so nervous. Okay, so as you can see by the title of this video, this is my testimony. I was supposed to film this video multiple times throughout the year, and I just kept putting it off and forgetting about it, and then here we are. Because I definitely, this was like one of my goals for 2021, was to film a testimony. So I definitely wanted to do it before the year's end. So I figured, why not during Vlogmas, you know, 'tis the season. I hope I sound clear. I hope this video isn't that long, but I know it's going to be. I know it's going to be, and I'm not even gonna fit like the dirty details in here because it involves other people, so I'm not gonna go major into detail. And it would be even longer if I went into deep detail, you know? So I already know it's gonna be long. Thank you for joining me. If you sit through the whole thing, I admire you. I brought you guys. I didn't do this in my room because, you know, people are always in my house and I feel like this is definitely more intimate. I have oatmeal. So I brought you guys to one of my favorite spots to do Bible studies, like by myself and like my daily devotionals and stuff like that. I haven't been here in a while because I mostly like came here like every day during the week in spring because it was much nicer outside. And then I kind of stopped coming when it hit summer because it was way too hot to be out here. Because usually I'll park backwards, open up my trunk, put my seats down, get a little blanket, get all my Bible stuff, and I'll watch the ocean. Yeah, if you didn't notice, I'm near the ocean. And it's funny because I don't like the beach. But there's like the ocean is like one of my favorite creations that God made. I don't know what about it is. It's just like so beautiful to me. Even though I don't like the beach. Like I don't like getting sticky. I don't like going to the beach. I have to be really in the mood to go to the beach. But I love it. It just like every time I end up in awe of it. And I'll be staring at it for like hours when I used to come out here. And I usually parked on the other side, but since the sun's blaring and there's usually people out there, I decided to come to this side. So then it's more private and I don't get embarrassed that there's no one near me. And I remember like when I would do my Bible studies on the other side, I would just be in awe. And just, I would always imagine like Jesus walking on water, like in the Bible. And I would just imagine him in front of me and like me walking on water. I don't know. I've just always, the ocean's always been one of my favorite creations that God made, and that's why I thought it was fitting to come here to share my testimony. I brought everything with me because, you know, I'm a planner. I have my Star Wars notebook and I wrote down basically all the points that I want to hit in my testimony when I'm sharing it. But I don't know how to start this. Okay, first let's go through the disclaimers. I wrote a bunch of disclaimers. I wrote that this is a shortened version. This is actually much longer, in my opinion, than I'm sharing because I like to go into detail, but I'm not gonna do that here again because there's people involved in my testimony and I'm not gonna share their information and like our relationship information, you know? Okay, two, I'll say it later because it has to do with something inside my testimony. So there's no point in me saying it now and then confuse you guys. So we'll get to two later. Three, I'm entitled to my testimony. I always used to think like, I don't have like a crazy testimony, but it doesn't matter. Like every testimony is so beautiful, no matter if you went through really hard struggles or it was actually really simple how you found God, you know? And I'm entitled to how I feel, how the events that took place leading up, the events in my childhood. How do I put this? It's like, I'm so nervous because I don't even know how to say it. Like if you personally know me in my life, and you're watching this, and the things I'm gonna share, you feel are untrue. That's how you feel. You get what I'm saying? Like, I'm entitled to how I felt, and this is what I felt during my life, and like what led up to my relationship with Jesus today. So I'm gonna share it. Does that make sense? Okay, I hope that makes sense. I have another disclaimer, but it's for me, and it's don't cry. I'm not a crier. I'm not an emotional person. I have a hard time getting in tune with my emotions, but I've definitely become a little more sappy throughout the years, especially since giving my life to Christ officially. And so I don't feel the urge to cry, and even when I was writing down like my outline for my testimony and all that, I didn't get emotional at all. I'm not an emotional person, but I feel like the second now that the camera's on, I might get emotional. So I'm just like telling myself, don't cry. Everything happens for a reason. God put everything in my life, the bad things, the good things, the weird things, on purpose, I truly believe. And I think everything happens for a reason and it's all a part of God's plan. even the struggles that I went through, even if they're minor to other people, I think I wouldn't be exactly here today where I am if it wasn't for the littlest things and the biggest things happening in my life. Okay. So, and then I wrote two verses just to keep in mind for everyone that, you know, God can only judge us. And yeah, I'll put them on the screen right now. Matthew 7 and Luke 6. But yeah, okay, let's get started, guys. I'm so nervous. I don't know why. It's just like weird because I've never like shared like... And this isn't even like the full thing because, again, I can't go into detail, but okay. I made it like by bullet points. So number one, my life before Christ. I was born and raised in a Pentecostal household. My parents married young, or at least my mom married young because my dad was like in his late 20s, I believe. But my mom was like 19 and she, you know, she had kids at a young age. They met in church. So I grew up straight up Pentecostal, you know, the Holy Ghost moving through the church, all of it, all of it. I grew up in a Pentecostal household. So I always knew God and I always believed in him. I never, for some reason, which I'm thankful for, I never doubted that his existence wasn't real. I was very like, yeah, that makes sense. Like, I don't know. It's just always been in my heart that I knew it. Growing up in that, it was one of those like love-hate relationships. I'm sure a lot of people that grew up in the church can agree that it's like, it's kind of like forced upon you. Even if your parents don't make it seem like it is, it's kind of like an unspoken thing. Like, this is it. This is your life. This is how you operate. Especially when it's an old-fashioned Pentecostal church, like skirts to the, you know, past the knees and all that jazz. And like no makeup, no painted nails, no dyed hair, stuff like that. So then when I was around, not completely sure, I probably should have fact checked all this, but when I was around 6 years old, my parents got divorced. I definitely think that had a factor in how I viewed relationships. The key like theme of my life leading up to my relationship with God has a lot to do with relationships, romantic relationships. Not regular friendships and like relationships with my parents or anything like that. Like it has a lot to do with my feelings toward romance and like, you know, boyfriend, girlfriend stuff like that. I always grew up being a hopeless romantic. I always was. I love rom-coms. I am a sucker for like the most cheesiest things. Like even though they're so cringy, I still love them so much. I've always been that way. I remember from a young age, like I was like, I can't wait to be 16 in high school and have a boyfriend and all this. Like I genuinely was in love with being in love. And I think, you know, watching your parents get divorced through a really rough divorce, like I get emotional. I knew this would happen. Watching your parents go through a divorce and like your view of love completely being changed, I would, you know, focus on those cheesy rom-coms and stuff like that. I'm gonna need a freaking napkin if I'm gonna cry this much. Yeah, I have no napkins, so we're gonna have to do it. Okay. Calm down. Calm down. You're not even, like, at the good part. Okay, so, yeah. I hope I'm making sense because I feel like I'm all over the place. So, you know, my view of love has always been in like fairy tales, I guess you can say. And it didn't get practical until 2020. But moving on from that. So, you know, you get a background of me. That's what I'm trying to set up to get to the point. Getting in more into relationships. After my parents got divorced, that's the life I've always known is, you know, separated households, a broken family. It's given me many blessings, I would like to say, because I don't want it to make it just seem like, oh, she has, you know, terrible broken family, all this. I love my half brother and sister so much. I don't even call them half brother or sister. They're, when people ask me, I'm like, that's my brother, that's my sister. I have an amazing stepdad, and I just, you know, I have a good family bond. Another like disclaimer, I have a good family bond, but it's never always been good. You know, we've had our rough patches. It is a long time coming to get to where it was today. Going on to an older age, I never felt like I was looked at as a pretty, beautiful girl. I never felt that I was attractive growing up because it was never me who had the attention from boys. And that really messes up your self-esteem. Like, really, really. Like, it's funny because I didn't have major problems with self-esteem because personality-wise, so it's gonna sound so conceited and cocky, but, like, personality-wise, I always knew I was cool, you know, like, even if I was an outcast sometimes, I always knew that I'm funny, I'm cool, like, I always had that validation for me, because I just knew, like, I'm freaking awesome, but physically, I was always so insecure, so I never had a boyfriend. I've never had a boyfriend, like, till this age, till 23 years old, I've never been in an actual relationship. I've never had that label. I didn't start getting attention from boys until after high school. And it's because I would download Tinder, Bumble, all the dating apps. And I was so infatuated. I don't know if that's the proper word. Like, so obsessed with that, like, confirmation. Like, I had a bunch of matches. Like, I'm not trying to sound conceited or anything, but, like, I had, like, over 1,000 matches on Tinder or something. And that's not even counting the ones that I would match with. And it was just like, and I would get so much like validation and like a kick from just matching, even if it never went anywhere. It's hard to do this and because I start losing my train of thought and it's like, okay. I feel like I don't want to miss any points. During this time, I didn't have like a solid relationship with God. I prayed every once in a while. I knew he was there. Never made any effort though. As far as church, I was in and out. Like, after my parents got divorced, I didn't go to church for years, and then I went back in, and then it was whatever my parents were doing, you know? Like, anytime my parents were serving the Lord, that's when I would go to church. If they were serving the world, then that's when I would be in the world. But it was always one of those things where, like, we still knew God was there. We just didn't make any effort. So after high school, when I went through that phase of like, oh my gosh, boys like me. And I would like swipe. I went on dates. I would date. I never was in a relationship, but I would date constantly. Multiple dates. I would go on dates, you know, movie dates. Go bowling, stuff like that. It was only 6 guys that I dated, that I went on dates with. Out of those guys, it was a span of like 22 dates. I did the math. Out of those 6 guys, only 4 I kissed. And like, that's as far as we got, was kissing and like touching. But like, that's it. It's so awkward because like, if my family watches this, I don't want to go into like detail because that's embarrassing for me. But yeah. And out of those 6 guys, I did some real math, guys. Out of those 6 guys, only one of them I felt that I truly liked. I'm not gonna say any details of who, because like, if any of them see this, I don't want to hurt the other one's feelings, you know what I mean? It's like and out of the 6 guys, only one of them asked me to be his girlfriend, and I said no. And that is another story, but the gist of it was that it felt wrong because I knew he wanted things that I didn't want. So during those 6 those 6 dated guys, I don't know what to call them because they never were my boyfriend. We never said like, this is my boyfriend, this is my girlfriend, like, you know what I mean? And it was in a span of like, I would say probably late 2017 or like early 2018 up until probably like 2020. So 18, 19, 20, it's like 4, 3, something like that. That's all I would do. And it felt very empty. It always felt like it was missing something. Like, I felt like every single guy that I would go on a date with, it's just 6 guys, but every single guy that I dated, it just felt empty. Like, it felt like something was missing. I would look to these romantic comedies and to these fairy tales, so I would be on these dates and I'd be like, I don't feel anything. Even like, you know, when you kiss and stuff, it's like not the same or whatever. I would say from 2017 to 2020, I battled a lot with depression. And like, it wasn't full-blown like I'm in a hole for months on end. I would get these depressive episodes because I bounce back very easily, so it would be like I'm fine 1 minute and then the next for like a whole week or for a day or depending however long it decides to last, I would be depressed. I also suffer from anxiety. I still do suffer from both. The depressive episodes, they actually happen when I'm not closest with God. And it's pretty obvious that's why. I won't read my Bible. I won't worship. I won't do anything to be present in the Lord. And that's when my depressive episodes really, really come out. But in 2021, I only had like 3, maybe 4, compared to 2020 and all the years prior where I would have them like every other week. I'm just trying to make, I feel like I'm all over the place, so I hope when I'm editing this, I could somehow make it make sense. I also suffer from a lot of anxiety. I said that already, but I'm gonna go a little more into detail on that. The anxiety I've had my entire life, basically. I remember talking to my dad about it when I got older, and he said, like, right around, like, when your mom and I separated or whatever, is when I could see that you were showing signs of it, because I would always be like, oh, my stomach hurts, because I'd get, like, those, like, anxiety, like, cramps, and, like, I would get so worried that it would cause me to be nauseous, and he would have to like rub my belly and all that. And he figured it was anxiety, because it would always be, you know, it would be right after something like traumatic happened to me or something like that, or it'd be every time I would start worrying about something. So he knew it was probably anxiety, but never addressed it, which that's, I don't blame my dad for that, because anyone could have addressed it. And also, since I grew up with anxiety, I've hid it very well. I didn't open up about my anxiety literally until probably last year or this year. Like, I'm becoming more comfortable talking about it. Like, even in high school, I remember, like, after high school, I was talking to a friend, and I told her, I was like, she was confiding in me, telling me she got diagnosed with anxiety. And I told her, wow, I never was officially diagnosed, but I grew up with anxiety my entire life. And she said, no way, because I don't show it. I've never had an anxiety attack in front of anyone, ever. Maybe as a kid, but like in my older years, never had an anxiety attack in front of anyone. When I know it's coming, I will hide. I never shared any of that with anyone. This past year, 2021, during my brother's birthday, I went to the bathroom and had an anxiety attack while there was like 10, 13 people at the table enjoying their dinner. I was in the bathroom losing my mind. Now they happen rarely. I would say probably after high school, they stop happening that often, because as I got older, I would know what triggers it, so I just refused to go around what triggers it. And now that I'm talking about it with my family and my close loved ones, they definitely, like, I've been able to open up and been like, please don't bring this up or whatever, because it causes me anxiety, you know, stuff like that. And they've been able to respect it, which is really nice. I don't know why I've brought this up, because like, this wasn't even on the list, but I just wanted to share that I suffer from both of those things, and they've definitely gotten better since giving my life to Christ. But back on track, the thing that led me, point two, how I realized my need for Christ. Oh, I wrote down that I can't even read my own handwriting. Oh, that I always knew it in the back of my mind. Growing up in the church, again, I always knew that God was there, always believed in him. And I guess because of that, because I grew up in the church, I didn't like, and I grew up in a Christian household, I didn't think I needed him. Does that make sense? Like, I knew he was there, and I, like, that's God, like, he answers my prayers or whatever, but I didn't think I needed him. I thought, that's it, like, that's God, this is us, that's our, like, that's how it goes, like, we go to church, stuff like that. Like, you know, I don't need him in my life, it's just, like, it's a comfort. Obviously, now I'm like, I need him 24/7. Yeah, I think that's it covering, I think, even though I was all over the place, hopefully in editing I was able to get the gist of it. I think that's it for my prior life to, like, you know, the big thing to leading up to how I received him. I received him at a young age, around probably like preteen. I'm not sure exactly when, but I think it was like around middle school leading to high school, probably around there. And I officially received him. But again, it was like, okay, like, that's it. Okay, I did that. You know, I feel like people that know will relate, but then people that don't know, they're like, no. But I didn't feel like I truly received him until 2020. I went on dates all the way from 2017 to 2020. And I constantly went in a vicious cycle of, I'm done with dating apps, deleted them, got back on them because I wanted to feel pretty, wanted to feel validation, etc., 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 etc. Just going in a circle, going in a vicious cycle, just constantly. Round and round. I just kept going through this cycle. August 2020 is when my life did a phew and like flipped around. I was dating this guy at the time. Nice guy, nice kid. In my notes, I like wrote down the personality of each guy that I dated, the six of them. And out of all of them, he was like the most kindest and sweetest one and very respectful. But again, time and time again, it shows up. I felt empty. I felt like there's something missing. Like, what's going on? This feels like meh. You know, every single relationship or situationship, whatever you want to call them, every date guy that I dated, it just felt like, I don't like them. And it wasn't them. It was always me. So I remember I was hanging out with this guy. I'm not going to go into detail. We like went on a date. I was leaving his house and I was in the car. And I was so upset with myself because I knew I felt nothing towards him. And I was in this position again. Now, backtrack a little bit. I have had my heart broken, per se. It's not always been where I kept hurting the guy. Out of all six guys, I think I only hurt like maybe two of them. All the other ones hurt me. I want to make that very clear. Or we hurt each other. Like, it wasn't me just constantly hurting these guys and being like, no, I don't like you. Like, it was actually, I think it was like more of them hurting me. But that's besides the point. I just wanted to make that clear because I don't want to come off across as like, oh dang, she wasted all these men's time. That's not proper English, but you know what I mean. It's like, no. I was hurt a lot. Really brought my self-esteem down. But I most likely hurt at least one of them. You never know, you know? I might have hurt all of them in one way or another, but as far as from my perspective, I feel like I only hurt like one, maybe two of them. I'm all over the place and I get so awkward because like if any of these guys watch this video, it's just like weird for me. And like, it weirds me out. But back to August 2020. Yeah, I was leaving this guy's house. I was mad at myself and throughout the years, I would always talk to God every once in a while and pray. And I remember I was like talking to God on the way home. I was like, what is wrong with me? Like, why does this keep happening? This is a vicious cycle. Like, I keep hurting myself by putting myself in these situationships and dating and trying to find someone to fill the void, but it's not working. I never felt anything towards anyone. It felt like I was like emotionless. Like I love the like giddy of like, oh, we're going on a date. But then the second like I would get to know them, it felt like a wall. And it wasn't their fault because all the guys were in their own way, you know, nice and special and good personalities, some more than others. But I never felt anything. And I always knew it was my problem. I knew it. I never blamed it on them. I never was like, ugh, you know, like some I blamed it on because again, some hurt me. But overall, I knew it was always a problem within myself that I wasn't feeling that like romance, the magic or whatever you want to call it that I was looking for because all I would do is watch rom-coms and I would either look at my parents for relationship, you know, views or movies and like fairy tales for relationship views, two worst things to be looking at because my parents were divorced and movies aren't real. Fairy tales aren't real. So I was in the car angry with myself asking God what's wrong with me. This nice guy likes me and I don't want anyone. I don't want him. I don't want any of the past relationships I had. I didn't want anyone. I wanted the fairy tale, you know? And I remember, it's freaking crazy. It's not crazy. I don't want to use that word. It's just, it gets me. And that's when God spoke to me and he said, I wrote it down. He said, how do you expect to have a relationship with someone else when you don't even have a relationship with me? Yeah, I think that needed a moment of silence to be a little dramatic. And I was like on the way home, it was a decent drive, probably like 30 minutes, and I was like shocked. I was speechless for a second. And then I was like, you're crazy. I wasn't like, you're crazy. But I was like, this is crazy. That I'm crazy in a good way. Like, crazy that this is happening to me. And I remember the second I heard that, in my head, I was like, all right, my focus is on God. And I just felt like, how do I explain it? What's the word for it? I felt like relieved. Like, I felt like every worry in my body was gone. Like, I started laughing in a loving way. Like, I started laughing and I was so happy. I've never been happier, considering I had to break a guy's heart. I feel bad, but like, it's literally, I was like smiling and giddy because, like, for the first time, I've truly felt like God was speaking to me and telling me this. And it was like, whoa. Like, it still gets me every time. Like, I was never happier in my life than in that moment. Because it felt like you were getting the answer that you were looking for, like, your entire life. And I remember just being like, whoa. Like, I remember laughing. I remember being so excited to get home and to just be happy. Because I knew what I had to do now. I remember telling a close friend of mine, one of my best friends, I was like, why am I so happy to, like, break up with someone? We weren't really breaking up because we weren't actually together, but, like, why am I so happy to break up with someone? I felt so bad. Like, it wasn't like I was happy in a way, because I was happy to be alone in a good way, like, to just be in a relationship with Jesus, other than a relationship with someone else that I didn't like. It's interesting how when you hit rock bottom, when you're at your lowest point, your downfall is when God lifts you up. I know that's not the case for everyone, but it was kind of the case for me. I definitely think I could have been in a darker place, because if I was, I'm gonna use a harsh slang term to get my point across, I could have been hoeing around, but I wasn't. Yeah, that's it. I just think it's interesting how God pulls us up from that, whether it's drug addiction, alcoholism, sexual abuse, or if it's just you going on dates and kissing boys and trying to fill the emptiness that literally only one person can fill, and you never even gave them the chance, which is Jesus, if you didn't get that part. So my last point, my life since receiving Christ, really receiving Christ. Because obviously, like I said, I received him when I was a preteen, but did I really receive him? No. I'm gonna say a couple things before I get on to, like, I love my life. I still have anxiety. I still suffer from anxiety. And it's still a really, really big struggle I'm facing. It's just as bad as it was before I gave my life to Christ. And that's why I'm gonna be real. Like, people, you know, some people say, like, oh, you know, like, you're gonna be free of everything. Not right away. I know one day I will be free of my anxiety, but as for today, 23 years old, you know, 2021, I still suffer from severe anxiety. I still, once in a while, get depressive episodes, but everything else has been, like, true bliss. I've never, ever been happier than I am now, like, the past year and a half, mid-2020 to now 2021, almost being over, I've never been happier. I've never been more confident. All those guys that I would confide in for confidence, never happened. It was always empty. I've never been more confident now. And I'm actually at my heaviest weight, and I've never been more confident now than I've ever been. Because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. I've never been more happy, more confident. I've never had healthier relationships with my family, even with my friends. And I don't have friends who are Christian. And I still have much better relationships now with them than I have in the past years. I know I'm crying, but I swear I'm so happy. I'm crying like happy tears, because I truly have never been happier. And I'm crying because I've come so far. Now when something happens to me, the first person I turn to is God. I can't believe I'm crying on camera. What is wrong with me? I've also received gifts from the Lord. I received words. I've received the gift to speak in tongues. That was crazy too. Again, when I say crazy, I mean it in a good way. I don't mean crazy like it's crazy. That's just how I talk. I have not had any sexual urges, I guess, but I've never really been one to have any, or I've never had the urge. I've never felt like that, like, loneliness of like wanting to get on those apps for a while now. I would say it hit me a little bit this past season because it's cuffing season, as the young kids say. Like, the holiday season always gets me very, like, depressy because all the couples and all the, like, love around me, it, like, makes me sad that I don't have someone to share it with. But then that's when, oh my gosh, my makeup is so bad. That's when I confide the most, or that's when I'm supposed to confide in the most into God. And I always freaking... the enemy gets me, and I always forget, and I always turn, and I have to keep reminding myself, like, have patience in the Lord, and, like, just have discipline. It definitely takes discipline. It definitely is one of those things where it's like the gym, you know? Like, if you want to lose weight, even when you don't feel like working out, like, go work out. It's the same as even if you don't feel like reading your Bible or worshiping or just being in the presence of the Lord, you still should be doing it. You still have to do it. And you never regret a workout, and you never regret reading your Bible. I'm like actually really happy being alone. I know people say that, and it's like, I definitely don't like the loneliness aspect, but since I confide and actually have a relationship with God, that's what fills the void. That's what fills the emptiness. Like, I'll still get the urges of like, oh, I'm so lonely. But then I'm like, but you like being alone. I think that brings it to a close. That's essentially what a testimony is, just sharing you where I'm, how I got here today and where I'm at today. I would say I hope this inspired someone to like share their testimony or like read your Bible or just look into being in a relationship with God. But like, I don't know how inspiring my testimony could be. There's no like a crazy like turn or something, or like, you know, it's not that dramatic. But definitely, if you are a female or a male and you're watching this and you've always felt what I felt, that emptiness, nothing ever satisfying you, I'm not even gonna say anything. I'm gonna just show you it. Literally right here. It's also right here. That's all I'm gonna say. I think that's it. I really feel like I'm gonna watch this back when I'm editing, and I'm gonna be like, you missed a bunch of different points. But I think that's it. I think I did it. Lauricimos, we did it. Now, am I gonna have the courage to post this and upload it? We'll see. Well, you'll know if you're watching it right now. Since I'm not editing it yet, I feel like I'm all over the place. So I'm really worried that it's not gonna make sense. So let's do a little recap, little summary. Grew up in the church, didn't really have a relationship with God. Parents got divorced, messed up my perception of love and relationships and of marriage. Some other bad things happened to me. Dated from 2017. To 2020. Never was in a relationship. Never had a boyfriend. Still don't. Would I like one? I wouldn't complain, but I don't feel the need for one. God spoke to me on a car ride home from a date. That's it. Rest is history. After that drive home, I gave my life to Christ, but really gave my life to Christ. And now I can't wait to be baptized. I'm so excited. I can't wait to be baptized, but that will be my goal for 2022. I already know that this is gonna be the highlight of my day, so I'm just gonna be like on a high the rest of the day. Thanks for watching this video. Don't forget to like and subscribe. All my social medias are down in the description below. Do not hesitate to DM me if you need someone to talk to or you want a sister in Christ, because I don't have any Christian friends.
Don't forget to read your Bible, guys, because I'm always forgetting and I always feel so bad afterwards.
And I will see you guys tomorrow for Vlogmas Day 6. 6? I believe so. Okay, bye. My name is registered in heaven. Yeah, my praise belongs to you forever. This is my testimony. I really hope I'm not forgetting something, because then I'm gonna be editing and I'm gonna be like, stupid, 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 stupid. Jesus loves you. And I do too. Bye.